I'm very pleased to welcome all of you. Many of you are familiar faces. Some of you are new to the school. But it's my great pleasure as the director of the Warren B. Rudman Center for Justice, Leadership, and Public Policy to welcome you this morning. My name is John Grabe, and I am the new director of the Rudman Center. The Rudman Center provides curricular and experiential support to students interested in public service legal careers. The center also hosts conferences, symposia, and public lectures that model and celebrate the collaboration necessary to solve our nation's pressing public policy problems. And that, of course, is one of the principal legacies of Senator Warren Rudman. It's my great pleasure to introduce to you the Dean of the University of New Hampshire School of Law, John Broderick.
Good morning, and thank you all for coming. If you haven't been to the Rudman Center before, I hope you'll follow the website and see what's happening. This October, we're having a conference here with three former presidential chiefs of staff. We'll have a number of forums and programs during 2015. And I was even bothering Mayor Giuliani this morning to see if I could enlist him to come back. It is a genuine honor to have the mayor here. He is known throughout the country and, frankly, throughout the world. And he wasn't born mayor of New York. He was born in 1944. Nice to find someone a little older than me, Mr. Mayor. I was born in 1947. But he was born to a working-class family in Brooklyn, and he was a grandson of Italian immigrants to the United States. Living the American dream, he graduated from NYU Law School in 1968 with honors. He clerked for a federal trial judge. He joined the U.S. Attorney's Office for the Southern District of New York, which is one of the best offices in the country. And he later became the U.S. Attorney for the Southern District. And he took on organized crime in a meaningful way, in a life-threatening way. He served as Associate Deputy Attorney General in the U.S. Department of Justice, served for Mayor of New York City for 8 years, starting in 1994. And during the mayor's tenure in New York, crime declined dramatically. Budget deficits became surpluses in New York. And I think it's fair to say that during his leadership in New York as mayor, the entire city of New York had a resurgence and a rebirth. But despite his accomplishments, which I've referenced, Mayor Giuliani, for most, will be remembered and revered in many ways for unmatched leadership for the city of New York and the country on 9/11, 2001, and the months that followed until his term ended as mayor. All of us in this room are old enough to remember where we were and what we were doing on that morning and how we pieced it together. It was an unimaginable experience. It still seems unimaginable. But none of us in this room, other than Mayor Giuliani, experienced the crushing weight of leadership with no time. With no time. It was, I think, in my lifetime, the darkest hour that I experienced as an American citizen. More people died in New York that day than died at Pearl Harbor. But Mayor Giuliani somehow, raised the spirit and resolve of the city he led. And in my view, for at least a week, he was the effective president of the United States. And I listened to him intently, as I know you did, and I trusted him. He went to funerals. He visited with families. As people were rushing from the World Trade Center, Mayor Giuliani was going to the World Trade Center. I honestly believe, Mr. Mayor, that the country can never fully repay the debt for your leadership on that fateful day. And I know the mayor's career is far broader than that. But I think for most Americans, they think of him in New York on 9/11, encouraging people following 9/11 to come back to the city, to shop, to visit. He was, I think, a far bigger personality than mayor of New York. He was then and is now a national, international figure who people respect. I count myself as one of those people. Before the mayor comes up to speak, and because he's going to talk about leadership today, I think with pretty impeccable credentials. It is the Warren B. Rudman Center for Justice, Leadership, and Public Policy, and I think Warren Rudman, Margaret Rudman, by the way, and Warren's sister, his nephew, are here today. And so we're delighted that you're here. I think Warren Rudman would be honored that the mayor was here, had come to New Hampshire to speak. But I wanted to show a brief video, I promise, and AJ, our tech genius, has pieced this together. I say that because if it goes badly, it's his fault. That's not a leadership trait, Mr. Mayor, but it's the truth, okay? But in any event, I think it will be fine, and I think it will bring us back to that day, which I think we all ought to see for a very few minutes to appreciate the person who will be speaking to us.
No, 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 get away from the
We're on. All that we know right now is the two airplanes struck the two large towers of the World Trade Center. We spoke to the White House. There also apparently was an attack on the Pentagon. We asked that the airspace around the city of New York be sealed by military aircraft. We've been informed that it has been, and we've seen military aircraft up in the air. So we're hopeful that right now things are secure. We need all of the open space we can get to evacuate people, to get people out, and we're going to have to move now and go north. So
for every single person touched by this unthinkable tragedy, there's been one man who, above all others, has been the beacon holding this city together and leading it forward.
This is a better city now than it was before the attack took place. And having gone through this experience back on the 11th, and then having gone through the experience with cancer the year before that, I kind of have a philosophy that goes something like this. Every day, you never know. You don't know what's going to happen to you. So you might as well take advantage of life, not go hide somewhere.
We're going to take airplanes when we're supposed to for business or pleasure. We're going to go to public events, and we're going to do the things that we normally would do. The best way to get your children to stop being afraid is to stop being afraid yourself.
Tell me, what is your philosophy of leadership? So many people are admiring your leadership just now.
I think that there are a couple of things. You have to lead by example, and you have to be honest. You got to be willing to work as hard as the people that you're asking to work with you and not be removed from them.
I'm here on behalf of a very grateful and very admiring city to tell each and every one of you how proud we are of you, and saying how proud we are of the innocent men and women who are going about their lives seeking their part of the American dream when their lives were cut short by the act of cowardly terrorists, and how proud we are of all of you who have come here to rescue them and return as many of them as we can to their loved ones.
There's no question we're going to rebuild. The skyline will be whole again, and also the reality is that the people in New York City are going to be whole again.
My pleasure to introduce Mayor Giuliani.
Thank you very much, Dean. Thank you. Thank you very much. I haven't seen some of that in a very long time, some of that footage. In fact, some of it I'm not sure I've ever seen. So I thank you very much for showing it to me and reminding me of it. On the 11th of May is the opening of the museum, the 9/11 Memorial Museum. It's a private opening. I think it opens officially on the 20th. and I just did a video for it, and we'll be at it. And I found it, strangely, more difficult to talk about now than I did back then, and than I did the first two or three years, because I guess you're not called upon to talk about it as much. It recedes in your memory, and then when you have to bring up all the memories, they're pretty hard, they're pretty difficult, and you remember all the people that you love so much that you lost. But I'm here to talk about leadership, and I'll tell you how that all fits together. At the time that attack took place, I was writing my book about leadership. It was in draft form. It was mostly finished. I'm going to say three quarters to almost 90% done in draft form. I had it in manuscript form. I had spent most of that summer and maybe most of that year on and off writing the book. So in a very strange way, I conducted the year 2001 almost as a seminar in leadership. I was spending my time trying to figure out what I did, why I did it, what worked, what didn't work, and trying to draw on examples from being mayor of New York City for 7.5 years, associate attorney general of the United States under Ronald Reagan, United States attorney. I had an experience for 3 or 4 years running a coal business in Eastern Kentucky that was in bankruptcy, taking it out of bankruptcy. I was trying to take all those experiences and trying to teach leadership. Because then, as now, I believe leadership can be taught. I think we should teach it as a course in college, maybe even high school. Because everything I learned about leadership, and writing the book confirmed this, I learned from other people. I always begin when I lecture in colleges about this, I say, are leaders born or made? And most people say made. Of course, they have to get born first. That's important. It's not irrelevant fact. But once it happens, most of what somebody knows about leadership, they learned during their life, which means they learned it from something or someone, which also means it can be taught if you can figure out what the principles are. So that's what I tried to do in the book. I tried to figure out what were the guiding principles that worked for me, and where did I get them? Where did I take them from? Now, before September 11, I think I wrote the book with a certain degree, I'd almost say arrogance, in believing I had been through everything. If you've been mayor of New York for 6 or 7 years, you believe you've been through everything, because New York is a crisis a week and a super tragedy a month, and we had airplane crashes, subway derailments, major fires, building collapses, strikes, West Nile virus, hostage situations, my goodness, you know, one after the other. And we had developed this Office of Emergency Management, and the whole purpose of that office was to look at our emergency planning and tell us what we were doing right, what we were doing wrong, and then developing a plan for us, almost like a book. How do you respond to a hurricane? How do you respond to a building collapse? How do you respond to the flooding of Lower Manhattan? How do you respond to West Nile virus? Laying out all of the roles for the mayor, the deputy mayor, police commissioner, fire commissioner. So one of the lessons I learned about leadership is when you're in the middle of a massive crisis, the more you've practiced, the better you are at it. The more this is familiar to you, because a massive crisis is never familiar. It always creates tremendous emotion. What grounds you in the middle of a crisis like that is if you can relate it to how you functioned before when things weren't as bad. So that's why preparation is so important. So when September 11 happened, I realized, my goodness, you never go through everything. There's always a new challenge out there in life. And I went back and rewrote the book for about 6 months with a feeling of much less arrogance and a lot more humility about how you never really know what's going to hit you. So it's filled with lessons of leadership, which I think are valuable both for people in government and for people in business and for people in life. And I'm so glad that the Warren Rudman Center has as part of its title leadership, because Warren Rudman was a leader in the sense that he was someone who stood for something that has always been difficult,
but has now become almost impossible, which is trying to figure out, and it sounds so simple, but it's so hard, figuring out how to solve problems, government problems, social problems, by bringing people together, by trying to find consensus, by trying to reach a compromise. And even back then, when he did it, and even more now, you need a lot of courage to do that, because there's such a desire that people stay in their little silos of left-wing, right-wing, liberal, progressive, conservative, right-wing conservative, not right-wing enough, left-wing Democrat, not left-wing enough. And then you get punished if you're a Republican and somehow you get the thought, my goodness, maybe we should raise taxes. Now you can be a Republican about everything else and they throw you out. If you're a Democrat and you say, well, you know, I'm a Catholic, I'm pro-life, well, gosh, they're going to throw you out. Senator Rudman understood something that's almost common sense that we somehow have lost, which is for a democracy to work, we have to find a way to get people that disagree with each other to work with each other, because that's what democracy is about. Democracy is about people are allowed to disagree with each other. Well, if they're allowed to disagree with each other, but then we have to function, we have to build roads, we have to solve debt, we have to figure out the right taxes, we have to figure out how to raise an army, we have to figure out whether to go to war or not to go to war, we got to figure out how to get the people that disagree with each other to agree with each other, which is called compromise. Very honorable thing. Now it's seen as selling out of principles. And I think Senator Rudman stands for that, and that is a principle of leadership, being able to stick to your principles, but realize that sometimes you're going to have to modify them in order to accomplish the practical. It takes a leader to do that because you get punished for doing it. So I'm going to list for you what I think are the six most important principles of leadership, and then we'll have a lot of time for questions. Here's the most important. You have to know what you believe. You have to have a set of guiding principles. Something has to motivate you. If you're going to lead other people, you have to know where you're taking them. If you're a political leader, you run a city, a state, or a government, you have to have things you want to accomplish that you can articulate to the people that are working for you, because if you can't do that, they don't know how to help you. If you try to lead, and I don't want to get political, but I am, and only out of excessive honesty, if you try to lead by following, which the president seems to like to do, lead by following. I mean, that's an oxymoron. Leading by following equals following. Leading by following means somebody else is leading, and if somebody else is leading, you are necessarily following. So it's the antithesis of leadership. It's a way not to make a decision. It's a way not to be held accountable. It's what ruins bureaucracies, whether in Washington, or New York, or here. What ruins bureaucracies is the unwillingness to make a decision. Because in a poorly run bureaucracy, and most of them are, in a poorly run bureaucracy, you are punished for making a mistake, and you are not sufficiently rewarded for making the right decision. Whereas in a well-run entrepreneurial business, yes, you'll be punished for making a mistake, but you can be grandly rewarded for making the right decision. And it's why one functions usually better than the other. So people lead by following because they're afraid to be held accountable. They don't want to be the one who suggests a certain thing to do that then turns out to be wrong. So the most important thing for a leader is to be able to spend a lot of time trying to figure out, what do you stand for? And my example, where did I learn that? I learned that from Ronald Reagan. I worked for President Reagan for 2.5 years in Washington, and then all those years in New York, but I was much closer to him when I was in Washington. I admired him greatly for many things, but mostly I admired him for the strength of his convictions. Ronald Reagan had a few simple convictions, but they were the most relevant convictions you could have at the time that he was president and governor and everything else. One, communism was evil. It had to be confronted rather than negotiated with. That all the years of negotiation were empowering communism to believe it could succeed. It had to be confronted. Very uncomfortable in his day to say that, because détente was the kind of intellectual thought that rule the day for both Democrats, Johnson, Carter, and Republicans, Nixon, Ford. His idea of confrontation was seen as provocation to nuclear war. It wasn't, but it was seen that way. It took a lot of courage to articulate those principles for a man who wanted to get elected, knowing that the majority of the American people, at least at first, didn't agree with that. Second view of Reagan was, having been a child of the New Deal, a supporter of Roosevelt originally, that the Roosevelt programs and the Great Society had gotten out of control. And from programs that used to move people out of poverty, they became programs that locked people in poverty through dependency. And they had to be cracked, they had to be broken, they had to be changed, they had to be opened up. And the third principle was, the only way you revive an economy is by putting more money back into the economy. A concept he borrowed, by the way, from John F. Kennedy, who did that in 1963. So he had three principles, that was it. And lowering the deficit, the one he didn't accomplish. Because he accomplished number one, we know that, right? He cracked the Soviet Union, ended them without firing a shot, by outspending them, by frightening them. He lowered taxes, one of the greatest tax reductions in history, 11 years of economic growth. He changed government. Although welfare reform ended with Newt Gingrich and Bill Clinton, he began the whole movement toward welfare reform. And he couldn't do the deficit because he had to spend too much money cracking the Soviet Union. So what he was able to do, which is the thing missed about Ronald Reagan, is he was able to trade off priorities. And then he's often criticized now by conservative Republicans because he allowed taxes to be raised. But he had lowered them so much that he had the room to make those compromises, which is something that is completely missing now in modern executives, not just the president. The idea that you negotiate a government like you negotiate a business. You know, if you want to sell your house, you ask for more money for your house. If you want to sell your house for $500,000, you don't ask for $500,000. You ask for $600,000. You give yourself room for the other person to think that they got you to reduce. Or if you want to buy a house for $500,000, you don't begin by saying $500,000 because you can end up spending $600,000. So you offer $400,000. You kind of meet in the middle. In politics, we now go in with our ultimate offer, right? Obamacare or nothing. I'm not going to compromise. Obamacare or nothing. Whether you like Obamacare or you don't like Obamacare. The president made a crucial mistake in not getting a single Republican vote for Obamacare. You do not shove a massive reallocation of our economy, a massive reallocation in the way we do healthcare, moving much more from the private sector to government control of it. You don't do that without some bipartisan support. All of the other major social programs passed, some of which have been very good and some of which have been big failures, were passed with bipartisan support. Social Security, the Great Society had Republican support. And to pass something like that, somebody should have told the president, even though he was a young, inexperienced, and rather naive president, this is going to build in years of massive discontent the minute you shove this down their throat, just because right now they happen to be in a minority. When they get into a majority, they're going to do what you did when you were in a majority. And of course, within a year, they got the majority in the House. By next year, they could have the majority in the Senate. And now we have the payback taking place. It shows a lack of leadership. And that usually comes from your unwillingness to compromise. Believe it or not, usually comes from not having strong views. People with the strongest views are usually the most, and most confident about their viewpoint, are the most willing to compromise. Because they realize that if they can get some of what they want, their ideas are so good, they're going to get the rest of what they want. Ronald Reagan used to say, if I can get 70% of what I want, I just had a victory. And even if I can only get 40 or 50% of what I want, I'm on the road to victory. Which means if he wanted to cut taxes by $4 billion, and he only got $1 billion, that was better than no tax cut at all. Because he was one quarter on the way to where he had to go. His other slogan that's worth remembering in this context of having strong ideas is, if somebody is my 80% friend, he's not my 20% enemy. meaning a political party can't be built on 100% agreement, because then it can't be broad enough. So if we can agree on 8 out of 10 things, we probably belong in the same political party. And that's how I'm a Republican. I agree with about 8 out of 10 things. The other party, I agree on 1 or 2 out of 10 things. So I'm a Republican. But I'm not a Republican because I believe in everything in the Republican Party. And I think that when you have strong views, when you know what you believe and why you believe it, you know how to compromise it without losing it. When you're insecure about what you believe, when you haven't thought it out well enough, when you're too naive, too young, too inexperienced, you're afraid to compromise because you're not sure what to give away and what not to give away. Which is why I believe that having strong ideals, strong ideas, is the critical part of leadership. And you develop those through study, through talking to other people, through thinking, through reading, through having an open mind. If you're running a business, you develop it with your key people so they can incorporate it, they can make it part of, you don't just impose. In the modern world, whether we're talking about government, we're talking about business, we're talking about sports, you no longer impose your ideas on other people. A good baseball manager gets his players to embrace what he believes they should do rather than telling them what to do. He gets them to see the value of it. And our great managers of the future, baseball, business, sports, government, military, are going to be ones who can get people to embrace rather than to just command. Because that's when people do things well. Second principle of leadership is a leader has to be an optimist. You have got to be an optimist. You have to believe that what you're going to do is going to work. Because you can't lead if you're a pessimist. If you're one of these people that just sees the problems, I used to do this when I trained a lot of young lawyers. Since we're in a law school, I might as well tell the lesson. But one of the things that happens with young lawyers, and I used to do a lot of litigation, is you're in this very, very big case, and let's say you write the first motion, you write a great motion, and you're all confident, all your young lawyers are real happy, and they stayed up all night, and then a month later you get the reply from the other side. The other side just devastates your argument. First reaction of a young lawyer used to be to run into my office, some of them almost crying, saying, we're going to lose. They thought of this, they thought of that, they thought of this. I don't know how we're going to answer it. They'd go on for about 10 minutes of panic. I let them do it, and I'd wait till they stopped, and I'd say, how much time do we have for this reply? And they'd say 30 days, 60 days. I said, in other words, this is not an emergency. They'd say, that's right. I said, well, here's my recommendation. I want you now to go back to your office and close the door. I want you to sit there for an hour. I want you to devote the first 15 minutes to repeating everything you just said to me. You can even yell, scream, and throw things around your room. Then I want you to stop after 15 minutes, and I want you to sit down and do the best you can to answer every one of the arguments. The best you can. Even if it's something stupid. Something weird. Any answer. You just come up with any answer to every one of these arguments. And then I want you to come back into my office after that and tell me your answers, even your stupid ones, to every one of their arguments. Just don't want you to give me an illegal one. I said because, and I'm doing this not because I want to be hard on you. I'm doing this to train you to be a leader. Because if you want to lead, you have got to be able to turn adversity into a challenge. How do we solve it? Or if we can't solve it, how do we fix it? Some things we can't solve. I don't know if we can ever solve poverty. I'm not sure we can ever, I know we can't solve crime. Doesn't mean we can't fix it. Doesn't mean we can't reduce it. So I want you now to just do the best you can to answer it. And then when you come back in, we can have a constructive discussion. We now know all the problems about how do we answer it. And it always worked, and they always came up with great answers. And the thing that seems so terrible at first always has approaches, answers, ways to handle it. Now that's what I mean by being an optimist. Being able to absorb the terrible things that are thrown at you in life, whether it's personal, government, business, and being able to take a little time to absorb them, not to deny them, but then once you absorb them, to turn them around into how do I fix it? How do I make it better? That can resolve a problem, or it can lessen a problem. Or the third principle of leadership is to be a leader, you have to have courage, which means you have to be willing to take a risk. You can't
live in a risk-free environment and expect to succeed greatly. Every great success, whether it's a great invention, a great business, a great military victory, a great political victory, all of it required tremendous risk. Certainly, it required the risk of failure, the risk that you can lose, you can be defeated, and no one can guarantee the answer to that. When someone decides on a new course for their business, a new product, or a new business to acquire, or a new territory to take over, there's nobody in the world that knows whether that's going to succeed or not. And if you've been the one to recommend it, this is where the courage comes in, and it's what's needed in a bureaucracy. If you're the one that recommended it, you're on the hook for it. If I just recommend that my company, which is basically a security company, decides to take on more cybersecurity and invest a lot of money to do more cybersecurity, I'm on the hook for it succeeding, right? But if I say my law firm should open an office in a particular place, because I think there's a lot of law business there, and I'm the one that recommends it, and it fails, well, gee, I'm in an awful lot of trouble, right? I look foolish. That's the reason people don't like to make decisions. They're afraid to be on the hook. That's why you need to develop courage. You need to develop a willingness to realize that you're going to fail a certain number of times, and you're going to learn from those failures. And you can't let that stop you from making difficult decisions. And there's a way to reduce the risk of difficult decisions. Most of what I learned about courage, I learned from the fire department. My uncle was a firefighter. He was a captain in the fire department. Like a little boy, like a lot of little boys, I just enormously admired the fire department. And then I got a chance to be the head of the fire department, which was fabulous. And here's what I admire about them. And I just spoke to a fire department in Hamilton, New York yesterday. A bunch of wonderful guys. And they're all the same, all over the country. Every time they leave for work, they may not come back. Every time they leave for work, that could be a day in which they have to walk into a fire and fire kills people in order to take other people out. And despite that, they do it. They do it with enthusiasm. They do it with tremendous courage. But what do they do to mitigate that risk? What they do is, my fourth principle, relentless preparation. They prepare. They don't just run into a fire. They don't just go take this person. You're a firefighter. Go in the fire. We're not going to teach you anything. We're not going to show you anything. We're not going to help you. Just go in the fire. What they do is they train their people excessively. They give them original training. They do more training. They do make-believe fires. They do fires of all different kinds. They keep working on the best equipment. They're trying to mitigate the risk, reduce the risk. And that's what came in handy September 11 so much. Because on September 11, we were hit with something much bigger than we ever hit with before, something we had not anticipated, something that was not part of our 20 plans for emergencies. We didn't have one called airplanes being used as missiles attacking our buildings. But what we did have was a plan for everything else. And in those plans for everything else were the plans for handling September 11. I learned this lesson from a great judge who was my principal teacher in becoming a lawyer, the judge I clerked for, Lloyd McMahon. And he taught me the lesson in a different context, the context of being a trial lawyer. And here's what he used to teach his young law clerks. If you're going to go to court, for every 1 hour in court, 4 hours of preparation. He used to call it the 1-for-4 rule. 4 hours of preparation. What that meant was, you have to anticipate everything that's going to happen in the court. You have to go over it. You have to get somebody to play the witness, somebody to play the judge, somebody to play the other lawyer or lawyers. And if you're going to put a witness on a witness stand, you go over every question, you go over every answer, you have every objection laid out in advance. You have your answer to those objections thought out in advance. If you're going to need a memo or a brief to answer a legal question to allow a certain amount of evidence in, you have it ready where the objection is made. You take out your brief and you hand it to the judge. Anticipate everything that can happen
the judge's command. And it worked for me many, many times. In court, giving talks, running businesses, running the city. That's the Office of Emergency Management was built on that principle, relentless preparation. Let's prepare for every emergency we can think of. But here is the real wisdom in what the judge taught. He used to say, no matter how much you prepare, no matter how much you anticipate, no matter how much you think of everything that's going to happen, something unanticipated always happens. Something goes wrong. The witness forgets, the witness lies. The other lawyer comes up with something you never thought of. The judge has some quirky idea that can only occur to judges, excuse me, Dean, that can only occur to judges. And all of a sudden, all the best laid plans of mice and men, the judge would say, no, no, that's not going to happen. He said, if you did what I said, if you did the 4-for-1, if you prepared and you over-prepared and you rehearsed and you went over it, he said, you know what's going to happen? It's going to be like a lightning flash. You're going to have the answer right on your feet. You're not even going to know where it came from. But here's where it came from. Because if you thought out everything you can think out, the unanticipated that's thrown at you is probably just a variation of everything you prepared. And your mind will immediately have the answer. And everybody will think, wow, what a great lawyer. This person thinks on their feet, but not thinking on their feet. It comes from all that preparation that was done, those hours and hours of thinking out everything. And well, that helped me, as you might imagine, in court a lot. But on September 11, it helped me tremendously because when I first got to the site of the World Trade Center, I had no idea how bad it was. And when I saw how bad it was, and I saw a man jump from the 101st floor, and I saw people being killed on the ground, and my fire chief told me, I can't save the people above the fire, just the ones below the fire. And I saw those people up there knowing they were going to die, and I was looking at them for the last time. I knew I was in something much worse than I ever faced before. Didn't have a plan, didn't have a book. But all of a sudden, I had to make decisions. I had to decide that we had to evacuate the area. I had to close down the bridges and tunnels so more terrorists wouldn't come in to attack us. I had to get air support for the city. I had to triage the hospitals. I had to bring in extra equipment. I had to get generators from General Electric so we could light up the area 24 hours a day so we could save the maximum number of people. I had to cover the priority targets that I thought the terrorists would go attack after September 11. As I made these decisions, like the one about covering the priority targets, I told the police commissioner, I said, Bernie, we're going to have to cover all the targets. He said, don't worry, we're already doing it. But boy, that gave me a sense of great confidence. It made me feel like my people really know what they're doing. And we really are prepared for this. Because we're prepared for everything else. We had prepared for terrorist suicide bombings. And because of that, we used to keep this list that we updated every month of what they were interested in. Where did that come from? It came from arrests that we made of them, taking their plans, taking their testimony, talking to the FBI, the CIA. We kept this very precise list of what seems to be their number one target, their 10th target, their 15th, their 20th. So when we had to deploy our resources, we didn't have to make that up in the moment of crisis. That was right there and we could work with it. When we had to evacuate Ground Zero, evacuate 400,000 people, we had an evacuation plan for Lower Manhattan, because Lower Manhattan is a flood-prone area. When we triaged the hospitals, we just used our plan from West Nile virus. So here's the point. They threw the unexpected at us, but because we prepared for everything else, we could handle it a lot better. And that's what relentless preparation is all about. And that's how relentless preparation reduces risk. If you're going to try something new, practice a lot. Try to remove as much of the risk as possible through relentless preparation. And the fifth principle of leadership, build a great team. Find people who know what they're doing. And find people who can balance you. All of us are good at some things and we're bad at other things. Part of the art of leadership is finding people that are good at what you're not good at, so it balances the team and it becomes better. Like if you are very, very good at handling people, dealing with people, selling the product, but you don't understand the product all that well. You're not a scientist, you're not into details, well then you go find somebody that is into details. Or if it's the other, if you're the scientist, if you invented the product, if you understand it better than everybody, you're not great at expressing it, They're not great at explaining. They're not great at handling people and motive. Then you find somebody that is and hire them.
Building a team means having a group of people that have balanced of talents, not one personality, not one talent. And that's part of the art of leadership, is understanding intimately that you cannot accomplish anything of any significance by yourself. You need other people. And in order to get the most out of them, you have to empower them. You have to find them, and you have to empower them. And the final principle of leadership that I'll mention is communication. You've got to be able to communicate with the people that work with you and for you. You have to let them know what you want from them. Most organizations that fall apart, you go interview the people, and they'll tell you, I didn't know what they wanted from me. They say I've been doing a bad job. I've been working here 3 years, nobody ever told me I was doing a bad job. And you don't know how often that happens. It happens because we don't know how to set up systems of accountability. And it's very important to leadership. When I wanted the goal of reducing crime, I realized I wasn't going to reduce crime just by wishing it. I realized I wasn't going to do it just by setting up strategies to reduce it. I realized what I needed was a way to evaluate whether my strategies were working so I could change them if they weren't working. So I helped to set up with the police department the CompStat program, which measures crime every single day in every part of the city and tells you, is it going up, is it going down? If it's going up, where is it going up? At what time of day? What type of crime? Do I have my police in the right place? Do I have to move them? I changed the police department from a sedentary, stationary police department assigned to specific police precincts, 77 of them, roughly 250 in each one of them. And I said, well, some of them don't need 250, some need 600. So my police department is going to be a floating police department. I can move them where the crime is. I can move them within a day, not go through a six-month process of review. I can move them within a day from here to where the crime problem is going up. And the CompStat program gave me a method of assessing my success. And then I took it and I applied it to welfare, and I applied it to corrections, transportation, and welfare. I said to my welfare workers, you're gonna have a new job. And the new job is gonna pay you a bonus over your old job. And the new job is you're gonna find work for people. Yes, you're gonna sign them up for welfare if they're entitled to welfare. But the most important thing you're gonna do is you're gonna find them jobs. And if you find them jobs, I'm gonna pay you a bonus. And if you find them good jobs, I'm gonna pay you a big bonus. And if you find them long-term jobs, I'm gonna continue to pay you a bonus for 2 or 3 or 4 years. Because I didn't want them just to find a job for 6 months and then have another person take that job for 6 months and they kind of churn. So we set up a JobStat program, and we trained our welfare workers into becoming employment agents. And we introduced something called Workfare, so that if you came for welfare, we assigned you to work. And we were allowed to assign you to work for 20 hours a week in exchange for your welfare check. And we assigned everyone we could to work in exchange for their welfare check. And the New York Times thought that was the meanest thing in the world. They did. And I was so proud of that. Because no one was more responsible for the deterioration of New York City than the New York Times and the support of the policies that they helped to support for 30 years that deteriorated the city. The city of New York did not deteriorate. Detroit is not Detroit because of bad winds. Detroit is Detroit because of very, very poor policies. Very bad anti-human nature policies that Detroit has been using for 40 years. That's why it fell apart, not because it's Detroit. Detroit is not terribly different than Chicago. Detroit's not terribly different than New York. New York didn't fall apart because we changed the policies and we instituted policies that made sense. And some of these are politically incorrect to talk about. But they're politically incorrect to talk about because we set up this area in which we don't examine solutions anymore, because if you suggest a solution, somebody gets insulted and makes you like a really bad guy. And this is where courage is so important and where communication is so important. So the end result with welfare was, with the JobStat program, the Workfare program, we had 1.1 million people on welfare when I entered office. We had 500,000 or so when I left office.
500,000 of those having jobs, 100,000 probably went to New Jersey. And Chris Christie is going to have to deal with them.
But what I'm saying is, part of leadership is
when you set up a goal,
you teach your people reaching that goal, you have to set up systems of accountability that shows them, are we getting there or aren't we getting there? That shows you, are we getting there or aren't we getting there? And then some of the goals that you set turn out to be wrong and you have to change them. But if you don't have a method of assessing, are you succeeding, then you can't make change. It's the biggest problem with America's public schools, because the teachers' union refuses to allow sensible methods of accountability for the teachers. Teachers are wonderful. Teachers are self-sacrificing. Teachers are terrific. Most of them. Some teachers stink. They can't teach. Is that so terrible? Some lawyers are awful lawyers. Some doctors are walking malpractice. Some politicians are terribly ineffective and crooked. Some human beings are failures at what they do. Well, it stands to reason that teachers can be no different, right? Some are going to be great. Some are going to be real good. A lot are going to be average. Some are going to be below average. Some are going to be awful, just terribly awful. To have to treat them all the same is a disservice to our students. What it says is that the job of the teacher is more important than the education of the student. So I describe the New York City school system as a job protection system first and foremost. It protects the jobs of the people in the system, because that they worry about that more than they worry about the performance of the children, which is why they fight any method of judging performance. I know methods of judging performance are inaccurate. I know that methods of judging performance are inexact. And I know sometimes unfair, but they are a lot better than having no method at all, no accountability at all, because accountability leads to being able to improve performance. And until school systems adopt this kind of an accountability, we're going to have this tremendous debate in this country about what do we do about our public schools, and what do we do about most of our children who are not getting the education they should be getting for America to be as competitive 20 years from now as it should be. And it may not be your child or mine. We may be able to have your child or mine escape that system, but your child and my child is going to grow up in America in which a lot of kids were not educated properly. And that is not going to be an enormously effective America. So it affects our children, even though we can get them to escape from the poor school systems. And that is probably the big challenge of the next 10 to 15 years, and the next big civil rights challenge, I believe. So thank you very much, and I'd love to take your questions.
Mayor Giuliani, thank you very much. You'll see that there are some note cards and pencils at the end of the aisle. So if you have questions that you'd like to write down, you can signal me and I'll come again. We have about 5 or 10 minutes. So in order to speed things up, I also can bring
So I was hoping somebody would get up and ask a nasty question, and I could do a Chris Christie interview.
Okay.
Who they say learned it from me. They say that I taught him that.
Mayor Giuliani, if I could kick things off, actually, another question. I think every generation probably tends to think of itself as more dysfunctional than the past. And even acknowledging that we have that tendency, I think it's hard for many of us not to look back at a time where we had leaders like Senator Rudman, who were not only men of integrity and character, but also were effective. It's hard not to think back to a time where Ronald Reagan and Tip O'Neill put aside differences and work together to address public policy problems. I wonder, do you think, are we drawing fewer leaders of character into positions of public service, or have there been structural changes or some combination of the two? If you agree, and it sounds like you do, that things are worse today than perhaps they were in our recent history.
I agree, but I do believe it's cyclical when we come at it. And I also can see people I can see people in the Senate, in the House, Republican and Democrat, and I can see governors throughout the country
who are able to do what you're talking about, who are able to do what a Warren Rudman was able to do, or a Jacob Javits, or a Tip O'Neill, or able to be highly partisan, very dedicated to their party, but then willing to make compromises. And I just think it's not the flavor of the day right now. And it's driven by in equal measure, but I don't think equal measure. I think it's driven by the president. I think it begins at the top. And then I think it's exacerbated by the Republican reaction to the president. And then finally, there's a whole other thing we should look at, which is maybe they're just expressing the disagreement among the American people. When you look at the House of Representatives, and we look at how they're divided, and we say, oh, it's a bunch of selfish members of Congress. You know something? They're reflecting the will of their electorate. I campaigned for about half of the Tea Party candidates that got elected in 10. And I'm not necessarily a Tea Party Republican or not a Tea Party. I don't like labels like that, whether you're Tea Party or right wing or left wing. I kind of think it inhibits thinking when you do that. So I always resisted labels. But I campaigned for them because I thought their basic premise was correct. Obama had made government too big. I am a passionate opponent of Obamacare. I think it's both the program itself is a total fraud in the sense that it's going to save any money, it's going to cost an enormous money, or help an awful lot of people. Half the people that are uninsured are going to remain uninsured 10 years from now. And so I was very opposed to it. They were I campaigned for them. They got elected. And I watched how they got elected because I was there in their district. They got elected by the American people in their district wanting them to go to Washington and overturn in any way they could Obamacare and stop the increase in government. So now when they get to Washington, if they don't fight very hard for that, haven't they double-crossed their people? And then to fight too hard for it because it's unrealistic means they're not serving the best interests of the country. So what I'm saying is that what you see in Washington, some of it is lack of leadership by the president. Some is lack of leadership by Republicans not willing to make some tough decisions. But a lot of it is actually reflecting substantial disagreement among the American people. We have a lot of people in America that believe government has gotten too big, that taxes are too high, that regulation is overburdensome, and that Obamacare is going to ruin our health care system. We've got a lot of people in America who feel taxes are too low, we should tax the rich more, government should be doing more, government should be stimulating more. And they really believe it. So what we need, and we probably have always had some of that, but what we're lacking now are people who know how to handle that. People who know how to handle this tremendous partisan division and figure out ways of how we can accomplish things. And I think we do need more people in politics like that, and that has to become an honorable thing to do. I think we have to change the feeling around the word compromise to something that is a sellout of principles to something that is an exceedingly courageous and intelligent thing to do.
Thank you. Here's a question that somebody passed in. You said your leadership book was 3/4 done by 9/11. What changed in the ultimate book?
Well, what changed were more attitude. If you read the original version, I don't think you'd like the book as much. It was done arrogant. It was, I faced everything and I know everything, and just listen to me and I can show you how to handle any emergency, anything that can happen. I think when you read this second book, first of all, it contains a lot of lessons that I learned on September 11 that I didn't know before. It contains a first chapter and a last chapter that describes September 11, I think in the most concise way I've ever gotten to describe it, but right at the time, you know, when I was, some of the facts are wrong.
Because it turned out 3 years later that somebody who was with me actually wasn't with me, but the emotion is probably even stronger.
And I think it has a more almost religious feeling to it. That there are things in life that we're just not going to ever be prepared for, and we just got to do the best we can and handle it and ask God to help us. Because people used to ask me, how did religion figure into I was a terrific delegator. I had the reputation of being a hands-on mayor who interfered in everything, and I used to be a hands-on mayor that interfered in everything. Denny, sitting back there, my counsel can confirm this. But once I got to trust you, and I did that when you first worked for me, once I got to trust you, I'd let you make all the decisions. Once I got to trust you. So you'd see me interfering a lot. That's usually when I was getting to know somebody, or I didn't think they were doing a good job. But if I thought you could handle it, I would entrust it to you. So I entrusted all my religion to Father Judge. Father Judge was a chaplain in the fire department. And he was a Franciscan priest, and he was a great man. And I was at the deathbed of 24 firefighters with him before September 11th. And he taught me how to deal with death. He taught me how to explain death to the extent he can to the wife, to the mother, to the children. So I would, whenever I would see him, I would say to him, Father Judge, pray for me. And he would say to me, you know something? You're a lot more effective. You pray for yourself. That would be a lot more unusual. I pray all the time. Maybe you pay attention. But he had a great sense of humor. And the reason I mention Father Judge is he is the first person who I was notified died after September 11th. When I got to the command post at the police academy, we started to get reports of people who died. The first report I got from the fire commissioner was Father Judge's body is being carried from Ground Zero to St. Peter's Church. Father Judge was killed outside the World Trade Center, so his entire body was recovered. Very few bodies were recovered because it happened before the buildings came down, probably when one of those things hit him. Probably when he was giving the last rites to somebody else who had been hit. So when I lost Father Judge, I lost my guy who I delegated religion to. So then I had to start to pray. And I found it very effective to say, I'm doing the best I can. Now you got to take over, because this is kind of beyond me. It helped a lot.
There's some great questions in here, and I apologize if we're running short on time. I think we have time for one more. Question, you spoke about entrepreneurship and effective government. And the question is, can democracy be entrepreneurial? And if so, how?
Yes. First of all, you got to separate the two things. Democracy, in the sense that how do we make our laws? We make our laws in a compromise process in which people vote on them, and therefore it's always best if a law that emerges can be somewhat of a compromise. Just like it's always best, not always happens, but it's always best in a business deal that both sides don't get everything they want, but at least get enough of they want to be happy. It's much better off in a business deal than when you take everything from the other guy and he's left with nothing, because all he wants to do is come back and sue you, try to find out if you're going to fail, figure out if there's something wrong with the contract. The best business deal is when both sides leave the table reasonably happy, never 100% happy. The best piece of legislation is a piece of legislation like that. Why? Because we are an essentially divided country. And the worst problem from a point of view of the president for Obamacare, I think the worst problem, but I'm on my side, you know, Republican side, is the concept. I think the concept is horrible. I think increasing the government's role in medicine is the worst possible thing we could have done. What we need in America is to decrease the government's role in medicine and increase the private sector's role. Even if it's more inefficient, it's more effective. But if you believe that you had to increase the government's role in medicine, and that's better, then you had to do it with Republican support. You cannot have not gotten Republican support for a major social change like that, because the Republicans then are going to be intent on killing it forever. They weren't intent on killing Social Security forever. They weren't intent on killing Medicare and Medicaid, and they even expanded it under Nixon, because they had been made part of it. And I think the president made a terrible mistake and didn't create but exacerbated this partisan division by doing that. So you have to learn, you got to bring the other side in.
Mayor Giuliani, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Wayne Sampritti over here, who was chairman of the state Republican Party, was instrumental in getting the mayor here. And he said, I'm sorry it took so long. I said, it was worth the wait. Can't thank you enough,
thank
Mr.
You.
Mayor. I just want to echo one thing. Katrina Sweat and Dick Sweat are here. And Katrina's father was Tom Lantos, who was a champion of civil rights and human rights in the United States and around the world. And he said one day to me something the mayor just said, and they're probably from different political perspectives, but they said the same thing. Congressman Lanzo said to me, John, in all my years in Congress, the most important things I worked on were the things we did on a bipartisan basis, because they last. It's very interesting to hear
That's
the
true.
Same point of view from people from different perspectives. One of the things you get pretty good at, Mayor, when you're a dean, is branding. Branding's pretty important. But it also comes with a lot of sincerity. The Rudman Center is a big deal here because it will affect young people. It may produce a Mayor Giuliani one day. Who knows? I hope so. But in any event, I want to give you a crystal cube done by a New Hampshire artisan here that has the Rudman Center logo. It sits on the
beautiful. Edge. Thank you.
And maybe have a desk to produce that.
I will. Thank you.
And I also noticed now, since I have cufflinks, whether people wear French cuffs. And so I was noticing the mayor did not have them on, but maybe he
But I do. I have a lot of shirts that have French cuffs. My wife prefers them. When I don't wear it, when she's around in the morning and I don't wear it, she gets upset.
Well, I'm going to support your wife.
Good. Well, she's going to love this.
Anyway, I want to give some cufflinks with the Rudman Center logo on them, and hope you'll wear them with pride.
And you should feel good about it because it'll replace my Yankee ones for a couple of
days.
Only a few days.
Thank you.